We are one step closer to custom shells, and on top of that, Valve has dropped a massive update. It updates the desktop experience, performance profiles, audio, input, storage, and a lot more. That's a lot to talk about in this week's Deck News Roundup, so let's get into it. What's good, Deck Gang? Welcome back to my regular Deck News Roundup videos. We're going to start with the news about the custom shells, but please don't forget to like and subscribe as we get started. It really helps the channel to grow, which is great for you because it helps me get Steam keys like the ones that I have added at some point in this video. Okay, so unfortunately, this may be only the back shell replacement for now. This news comes by way of today's sponsor, JSOX. A couple weeks ago, they posted a tease of what looked like a transparent cover for the Steam Deck, and I began to hope that they were working on replacement shells. I spoke to them, and they have in fact confirmed that they are at least working on bringing a back cover to market, but have had concerns about releasing a front cover replacement. Here's a tweet from them that reads like this, quote, "We are evaluating the transparent front cover replacement, but it is an extremely complicated installation process. Is there someone who can provide installation services for our customers? If you can, please contact us," end quote. So yeah, hopefully they can get some help. I won't name names, but I have spoken with other big accessory makers and they kind of echo that it's going to be difficult to bring a front cover to market because of the degree of difficulty on a replacement job. Hopefully we see one anyway, as I know a bunch of people that would like to do this and are willing to take on a difficult teardown and mod. But honestly, give me that back cover ASAP. I can't wait. Okay, so on Friday evening, Valve announced that they just pushed an update to SteamOS labeled SteamOS 3.4. Just so you know, this update is in the preview channel only. For that reason, I don't recommend you download this update unless you want to test these features and maybe even report to Valve with any feedback that you find. People have already reported several issues. As far as I've seen, the biggest among them is that decoding support seems to be broken in remote play and in other scenarios. To a large degree, this should be fixed by the time it comes to stable, but it appears that due to some patents, the Steam Deck may never have support for some modern video codecs, and that is extremely disappointing. Outside of that, it also appears that some Source 2 engine games, including Half-Life 2 and Portal 2, will just not launch by default in the new Steam OS. And this update appears to break dual booting for a lot of folks. Again, this should be fixed over time, but just be aware that you'll encounter stuff like this if you do upgrade now. Alright, so if you look at the patch notes, this is genuinely one of the longest patch notes for an update that I've ever seen for the Steam Deck, so as usual, the Steam Deck continues to be the fastest improving gaming device on the market. The patch notes are broken up into 6 sections, so let's talk about each of those. First is SteamOS itself. By the way, let me give a huge shout out to Nagito on the Fan the Deck Discord who talked through some of the updates with me. Anyway, as you likely know, SteamOS is based on a Linux distro named Arch Linux. So what SteamOS 3.4 does is basically upgrade to the latest version of Arch Linux. From a user perspective, the main thing that this brings is several updates to the desktop experience, as the desktop environment appears to have been upgraded from Plasma 5.23 to Plasma 5.26. Notably, you can enable a touchscreen interface that makes the desktop slightly more friendly to touch interface, especially with common items like the minimize and maximize windows buttons, as well as the system tray icons and context menus. This makes the environment easier to navigate if you're using the touchscreen and can be enabled by going to system settings, workspace behavior. At the bottom, there is an item for touch mode, which you can set to always enabled. You can also try alternative application launchers by right-clicking the Steam Deck button on the bottom left and clicking show alternatives. I really like the application dashboard, which looks like this, though I'd say it's a little tougher to use with the default Steam Deck controls. The new overview feature is nice as well. You can use the Super plus W keyboard shortcut for an overview of your open windows. I like this multitasking view better than Alt Tab, since what all is currently open looks a lot clearer to me from here. You can also type from this view to search for an open window, and I think that's really neat. Okay, and finally, my favorite new feature is animated wallpapers. Download any GIF and find it in Dolphin. Right click from here and set it as wallpaper. I can't wait to see if ETA Prime uses this new feature, but yeah, it's really fun. Anyway, if you're on the new SteamOS, you might as well give this new desktop experience a shot and see what you think. Definitely let me know in the comments. The next section in the patch notes is performance profiles, and there are two bullet points here. First, you can now allow screen tearing. I like the phrasing here, by the way. They could have went with a more traditional phrasing by referring to this toggle as VSync, but they instead are referring to it as screen tearing. I have my own thoughts on why they did this, but what would you say is the reasoning behind this decision from Valve? Let me know in the comments. Anyway, by default, VSync has been enabled on the Steam Deck's gaming mode, and up until now, there's been no way to turn that off. Now you can enable screen tearing, which basically disables VSync. The benefit of this is that it reduces input lag if that's a problem for you, specifically in competitive games. It also helps on games where VSync is forced and the two VSyncs kind of appear to compete with each other. In any case, the second bullet point for performance profiles is a big one. It's the new condensed performance overlay option. This is available in the level 2 setting of the performance overlay and therefore replaces the old level 2 option. Now the entire overlay is condensed to one horizontal line and it can even fit in the letterbox space of any games that run in 16:9 as opposed to the native 16:10. Here is Ghost Song as an example of this. I love it. Alright, we're gonna skip over storage for now and go to input. By default, the trackpad on DualShock 4 and DualSense used to emulate the mouse regardless of and in addition to whatever input you would assign to it. So if you assigned X to the trackpad and you pressed the trackpad, it would register an X input, but it would also register some mouse input for however your finger moved while you were touching the pad. That is now fixed with this update, so you're not getting this superfluous input. The big fix in the audio section is this bullet point right here. Fix the case where the default audio device would display echo cancel sync and audio controls would cease to work correctly. This was a big problem for a lot of people and I've seen it before as well, and now it should be resolved. From a more general standpoint, there's also a new firmware for the Valve docking station that fixes an issue where HDMI 2.0 displays are not detected during wake up or boot up, and there were otherwise a bunch of issues resolved, like a problem where the GPU settings would sometimes be reset even after you manually set them. Alright, let's go back to storage because this is really interesting, and this segment is brought to you by JSOX, so thank you to JSOX for sponsoring this video, and I'm gonna tell you why. You may have heard about their M.2 docking station by now, and this update has some really nice benefits for this already awesome dock. First, let me tell you about the dock itself. The star of the show, of course, is the ability to add an NVMe drive, but it also has all the features of their previous docks. That is, it has two USB-A ports, an HDMI port capable of 4K resolution at 60fps, a USB-C PD port for up to 100 watt fast charge, and a gigabit Ethernet port. It's built with the aluminum alloy and anti-slip grip that feels super premium, even more so than the official dock, I would say. And in addition to all of that, the unique thing about this docking station is that it has support for an M.2 interface SSD drive. You can buy it straight from JSOX with a 1TB drive, or you can buy it without a drive in case you want to install your own, like say something bigger like a 2TB drive. The installation itself is completely screwless. You can easily remove the metal plate to access the drive, and then there's this like silicone buckle that keeps the drive in place, again as opposed to a screw. You can just pop it in and push it out. There are slots for various sizes of M.2 drives, so you can replace the drive in your Steam Deck and then use the original Steam Deck drive in this fancy dock. That's pretty snazzy. So why am I so excited about this update and the M.2 dock? Well, because of the upgrades that Valve has made to external storage. First is the fact that the Steam Deck will now periodically trim storage devices, including the internal drive and supported external storage devices. This basically cleans up unused space by making sure that the deleted data is properly marked as deleted. I believe this works for the SSD in the dock as well. But more important than that is this last bullet point in the storage section. It says, quote, "External drives formatted as EXT4 are now automatically mounted and available for use in Steam." Well, let's put it to the test. Unfortunately, you still have to go to desktop mode to format an external drive. You can use KDE Partition Manager. Here are the settings I used. After you click apply, it takes some time to process and then it'll ask you to mount the drive. I mounted it and created a new Steam library from inside desktop Steam. From here, I installed Lunastis, which is awesome, by the way, on the new drive. Then I popped into gaming mode and I was able to play the game from there. And just to be sure this worked, I shut the Steam Deck down, unplugged the JSOC stock, and plugged it back in. And to be honest, it was still a little hit and miss. If you've ever inserted an SD card and you didn't see your library pop up immediately, then you know what I'm talking about. If you plug the Steam Deck into the dock, then most of the time you will see the drive auto mount if you're looking in the storage menu, but every few times the drive would not automatically mount and you'd have to unplug and plug back in. I expect this to improve as SteamOS 3.4 goes from preview to beta to stable. I also hope that Valve adds an option to format an external drive from within gaming mode, just as you can do with an SD card. Still though, you don't need this update to enjoy the M.2 docking station from JSOX. Not to mention, I don't know any other company that's making as many awesome Steam Deck accessories as JSOX. So if you want to pick up any of their products, make sure to use my store link in the description to help support the channel. So just in the last week, there have been some awesome Steam Deck or Deck adjacent videos, and I really wanted to highlight a few. First up is a deep dive from the Deckverse. This goes into Cyberpunk's new FSR 2.1 update on the Steam Deck, and as usual, Timo blends excellent production values with excellent data. Check that out. One channel that I failed to give any mention to so far is CryoByte33. Check out his latest performance boost video titled Easy and Safe Health and Performance Boosts. These go over scripts that he has written and implemented to improve the performance of the Steam Deck as well as extend the life of your SSD and microSD. He goes into deep detail about these improvements, and they are well worth looking into at the very least. This video does a great job of explaining what's going on. There's also a really awesome retrospective on the original Steam controller titled Steam Controller Review 7 Years Later. This is by a channel called Reluctant Anarchist, and it's a super comprehensive review of the divisive control pad that really gave us a preview into how Valve saw the future of PC gaming. He calls the Steam controller the Linux of game controllers, and I can really see where he's coming from, so yeah, check that video out. So let's give away a couple games, shall we? For this week's wishlist segment, I want to talk about Humble Choice. Humble Choice is a subscription that gives you 8 games to keep every single month. These are virtually always Steam keys, so you can just redeem them on Steam and play them on your Steam Deck. This month includes games like Hell Let Loose, Kingdoms of Amalur, and a standalone expansion to Shadow Tactics called Aiko's Choice. Not to mention excellent indies like RoboQuest, Elvis Souls, Unmetal, and Raji. I'm not gonna lie though, sometimes my subscription gives me access to games I already own, like I already own Deathloop, Forgive Me Father, Super Hot Mind Control Delete, and Descenders. So, you know, feel free to have those. Just follow the link in the card that should show up about now. In any case, in addition to those 8 games per month, you get access to games in the Humble Game Collection, including the awesome Signalis and Ghost Song. For what it's worth, I've had trouble getting the Humble Games Collection to work on the latest version of the Lucha's Flatpak, but you may have better luck than I did. You also get a 5 to 20% additional discount on the Humble Store, which can come in handy because, again, these games redeem on Steam. Anyway, the reason I'm bringing this up for this month in particular is because Humble is offering a 12-month subscription for only $89 if you use the code HOLIDAY22. I believe that's like a $40 savings for the entire year. If you're interested, I have a link in the description. It will be an affiliate link, so I get a little kickback if you use it. Outside of that, do be sure to check out Lunastis on Steam. It's an awesome 3D platformer with a low poly art style that's inspired by the PS1 and Sega Saturn generation. It's only $5 and it's currently on sale, so that's down to 4.25. There's a free demo, and if you like 3D platformers, I don't think you'll be disappointed. All right, that gang out. Goodbye.